Hello, everybody. I'm Tatsuya Akutsu from Biophotic Center, Institute of Chemical Research, Kyoto University. And today, I'm going to talk about this topic on the compressive power of Boolean threshold autoencoders. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me a chance to talk about my work in this. First, I will define a considered mathematical model, Boolean threshold autoencoder. And before talking about this model, I want to briefly mention about motivation and objective of this work. As you know, autoencoders are a special kind of neural networks in which input vectors should be the same as the output vectors, or input vectors should be nearly equal to the output vectors. And these autoencoders perform a kind of data compression. And extensive studies have recently been done for generation of some new novel data using these autoencoders, especially using variational autoencoders. However, no rigorous studies have been done on how data are compressed. So we started this work. And our objective is as follows. We clarify how data are compressed using Boolean threshold autoencoders, that is, autoencoders based on Boolean threshold networks. Boolean threshold networks are equivalent to threshold circuits, and thresholds, there are many studies on threshold circuits in theoretical computer science. And by using this model, we analyze how many nodes and layers are required to efficiently compress input binary sample data. So this is our objective. And next, I want to define our models and our problems. First, we assume that input is a set of n-dimensional binary vectors. It is the first vector, and we have the second vector, and third vector, and so on. So we have n binary vectors, where each vector is in d-dimensional binary space. And first, then we define two important concepts, perfect encoder and perfect autoencoder. And first, I will define perfect encoder. A mapping function, this f, from this domain to this domain is called a perfect encoder for this set of samples if two vectors are mapped to different vectors, or any two different vectors are mapped to different vectors. And next, we define this perfect autoencoder, a pair of mapping fg with f from this domain to this domain, and G from this domain to this domain is called a perfect autoencoder for this set of samples if this property holds for all vectors. That is, each output vector is the same as the input vector. So if this condition holds, the corresponding pair of function is called a perfect autoencoder. Please look at this figure. This is the input vector, and this is output vector, and this is the middle vector. The middle vector means that it is a compressed vector. And this input vector is compressed to this middle vector by using this function f, and this middle vector is then decoded to the output vector by using this function g. And this xij denotes the jth coordinate of the ice sample. Okay. Next, this pair of fg can be extended for multiple layers. For example, in this case, there are five layers. And this is input vector, and this is output vector. And this is the middle vector. And we this f corresponds to the combination of composition of this f1 and f2. And this decoder function g is a combination of this function f3 and f4. head by using these middle and input and output vectors, we have this proposition. If FG is a perfect autoencoder, then F is a perfect encoder. The proof is easy, but I omit details because of the time limit. Next, I will show some examples of autoencoder. But in this case, we consider Boolean network, which is a Boolean network is a well known in bioinformatics. It is a mathematical model of genetic networks. And in this Boolean network, we can consider arbitrary Boolean function. And for example, we consider these four input vectors, x0 equals 0, 0, 0, x1 is 1, 1, 0, 0, x2 is 1, 0, 1, and x3 is 1, 1, 1. And let this large D be the dimension of the input and output vectors, and this small d be the dimension of the complex vectors. And this G, Z is a middle vector, and this Y is the output vector, and which can be obtained by this Boolean function, this Boolean function. And please look at this table. This is input vector, this is another input vector, this is another input vector, and this is the other input vector. And this input vector is compressed to this 0, 0 by using this Boolean function. And this 0 is transformed into this 0, 0, 0 by using this Boolean function. And also, this vector is transformed into this vector, and then this vector is transformed into this vector. And this one is transformed into this vector, and then this vector is transformed into this vector. And this vector is transformed into this vector by using these two functions, and this vector is transformed to this vector by using these three G functions. And you can see that this vector is the same as this one, this vector is the same as this one, this vector is the same as this one, and this vector is the same as this one. So these functions are constitute a perfect autoencoder. And we can have this proposition. For any set of any dimensional binary vectors that exist, a perfect Boolean network autoencoder having this dimension in the middle layer. The proof is easy. Since we consider arbitrary Boolean functions, any F and BG can be realized by using a Boolean network. And we define F to map each input vector xi to a binary representation of this integer I. And we define G to map each such an integer I to xi. Then FG, this pair of function, is clearly a perfect autoencoder. So this is a very simple proof. But in this case, we consider arbitrary Boolean function. But for neural networks, we should consider only. Next, I will talk about Boolean threshold encoders. In this case, we consider threshold function as the linear threshold function as the activation function in layered network. First, we show that this cell. This cell mentioned that for any set of n vectors, there exists a two-layer perfect encoder which transforms the input vector to this small d dimensional space, the dimensional vectors, whose activation functions are parity functions. Parity functions are not linear threshold functions, but for the ease of the presentation, first I will use this parity function. And this is a sketch of proof. Let sk be a random binary vector of size n, where k begins from 0 to k ranges from 0 to d minus 1, and let fk xi be the parity of the number of bits with value 1 in this vector. And this is obtained by bitwise AND of this vector and this vector. Then for each k, this property holds for any two different vectors with probability 0.5. And thus, this property holds for any different vectors with probability of this number. Then the probability that this property holds for some pair is smaller than this. And this probability is less than 1 if d is larger than or greater than or equal to this number. And in this case, this probability is less than 1, so there exists, so which means there exists the required encoder. And please look at figure. This is an example of xi and this vector, and this is an example of xj, this vector. And suppose that we have this sk, this is a randomly generated binary vectors, then xi and xk is given this, and xj and sk is given this. And in this case, there are two ones, the parity is zero. And in this case, there are three ones, so the parity is one. So this is some example of this construction. And it is well known that parity function can be realized by two-layer Boolean threshold networks. So we have this one. For any set of n dimension, n vectors, then there exists a three-layer perfect encoder which maps each input vector to this small d-dimensional vector using this number of hidden nodes. Please note that this large d is the dimension of the input vectors. Next, I want to briefly show some another construction of the perfect encoder. We have this theorem. For any set of n binary vectors, there exists a two-layer perfect encoder which maps input vector to this n-dimensional middle vectors. The proof is easy, but there is not much time, so I want to skip the proof. And if you are interested, please look at this example. Then you can see that how this two-layer perfect encoder will be constructed. Of course, this result is not meaningful because the data is not compressed because the dimension of the middle layer is large. But this concept will be used as a kind of some subroutine for constructing more efficient encoders and decoders. Next, I want to explain perfect Boolean threshold autoencoders. First, I want to show some negative results on decoding. We have this theorem. For each d, positive integer d, there exists a set of n equal 2 to d defined vectors having these properties. For first property is that there exists a two-layer Boolean threshold network that maps this x to this dimensional space, binary space. But there does not exist two-layer Boolean threshold networks that maps this compressed dimensional space into the original vectors. We only show this theorem for the case of d equal 2. In this case, we consider these four vectors 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, and for these vectors, by taking the first two bits, it will be a perfect encoder because the first two bits of this vector is 0, 0, and first two bits of this vector is 0, 1, and the first two vectors, two bits is 1, 1, and first two bits, bits are 1, 0. So by taking the first two bits, it will be a perfect encoder. And since these four vectors are symmetric, we assume without loss of generality that the decoder maps this 0, 0 to x0, this 0, 1 to x1, and this 1, 1 to x2, this 1, 0 to x3. And please look at these six coordinates. So this is 0, 1, 0, 1. So by looking at this six coordinate, we can see that its projection to the sixth coordinate becomes this. 0, 0 should be mapped to 0, 0, 1 should be mapped to 1, 1-1 should be mapped to 0, 1-0 should be mapped to 1. But there is no special function giving such a mapping, which can be seen by this figure. So this 0 and this 1-0 must be mapped to 1, but this 1-1 and this 0-0 should be mapped to 0. But there is no hyperplane, no half space which discriminates these four vectors are this. Okay. Next, I will show existence of perfect Boolean threshold autoencoders. We have this term. For any set of n vectors, there exists a three-layer perfect autoencoder which maps input vector into this small d-dimensional space. And we use the encoder shown in some previous slide, and we construct decoder by using this function g, which is defined by this threshold function, where these weight vectors are defined as this. Since there is a time limit, I will not mention about the details of this. And this shows some example. And in this case, we use these weight vectors. And by modifying the construction, we have these theorems. This theorem means that let R be this number, then for any set of n binary vectors, there exist a five-layer perfect autoencoder with this number of nodes in the second layer, this number of nodes in the third layer, and this number of nodes in the fourth layer. Similarly, we have this cell. Now, I would like to summarize this talk and brief mention about future work. In this work, we introduced two concepts, perfect encoder and perfect autoencoder. And by using these concepts, we showed some results suggesting that decoding is more difficult than encoding. And we also obtained these results, these upper bounds on the number of the dimension of the middle layer and the number of nodes used in each layer. And in this table, this large D denotes the dimension of the input and output vectors. This small d denotes the dimension of the compressed vectors. And this n denotes the number of samples. And btn denotes the Boolean threshold network. These are the future work. The results we obtained are not necessarily optimal. So improvements of the result shown just before is some important future work. And also, we analysis of the approach method of autoencoding is important feature, because in practice, the input vectors are not necessarily the same as the output vectors. So we need to consider the situation in which the input vectors are similar to the output vectors. Also, we assume that Boolean threshold function as the activation functions, but in practice, Boolean threshold functions are not used. So we need to analyze autoencoders with more practical activation functions, such as ReLU functions and some other functions. Finally, I would like to thank these co-authors of this paper, because this talk is based on this paper. So I would like to thank co-authors of this paper. And this is end of my talk. Thank you very much for your kind attention.